It is now being called the biggest organized protest in the history of the world. But what are the real issues here, and what are these protests actually about? Answering these questions and many more, we have with us Devinder Sharma, one of India's leading agricultural specialists and food policy analysts.
Many people believe that it is just the central laws, the three central laws, that has agitated the farming community, and that is why they are at the doorsteps of New Delhi. But the way I look at it, it is actually the compound anger that has been built over the decades, and that is actually finding a vent now, and that anger is coming out in the form of course, protest to the central laws. But let's not forget that in the last three, four decades, agriculture has faced grave injustice and also inequality, and they have been deprived of their dues or deprived of their rightful income all these decades. Now, just to illustrate, I remember a United Nations study by UNTAD, and it had said that between mid-1980s and mid-2000, 20-year period, they had worked out that the output price or the farm gate price of agriculture or in agriculture has remained static or frozen across the globe. Now, I think we must understand that that means that, let's say, in the middle of 2000, what the farmers were getting was almost the same if you adjust for inflation as to what they were getting in mid-1980s. So I think this should tell us that for 20 years, globally, the prices or the farm gate prices had remained static or frozen. The rich countries, of course, address this issue by providing direct income support and a whole lot of other privileges to farming community. But the developing countries or the least developed countries could not afford it. And so I think farmers in these countries have silently suffered the consequences of the frozen income. Then comes a study in 2000, it is by OECD, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, along with a New Delhi think tank called ICRIER. And this study estimated that between the year 2000 and 2016-17, which means the 16 years at a stretch, Indian farmers lost 45 lakh crores. Now, 45 lakh crore is an extraordinary crisis, but I don't think anybody discussed that as even a crisis that hit agriculture or that farmers were living under all these years. And in this study, they worked it out. It was for a handful of crops. So I guess the total extent or the damage or the loss that the farmers had suffered must be quite significant or higher than what we have seen, 45 lakh crores, which means roughly a loss of about 2.64 lakh crore every year. Now, this was because farmers were denied their rightful income. Farmers got 15% less, and the beneficiaries were the consumers, who also gained by 25% as far as the consumer prices were concerned. Now, if you look at another report by the Economic Survey in 2016, the survey tells us that the average income of a farming family in 17 states of India, which means half the country, is only 20,000 rupees a year. Now, 20,000 rupees a year means less than 1,700 rupees a month. Now, I can't even rear a cow in 1,700 rupees a month. I wonder and I shudder to think how the farming community has been surviving in less than 1,700 rupees a month in half the country. So it tells us that agriculture has been passing through a terrible crisis all these decades. And now, at this particular juncture, in the dead of the winters, if the farmers have assembled at the borders of New Delhi, I think it tells us that they probably feel that enough is enough. The academia, the elite, the economists, they all failed to help farmers to get their rightful dues. So I think farmers have now taken it on themselves that they have to take it, or they have to ensure that they do not suffer the consequences any further, and they do get a kind of assured income. I think that is what they are fighting for at this particular juncture. With these farm laws coming in, they fear that whatever they could survive with is also going to be snatched away. So that is what has push them into this kind of a protest, which it's an iconic protest, it's an iconic movement, the kind of which at least I have not seen or followed anywhere in the world earlier. If the Punjab farmers were rich, that should have been a model for the rest of the country to follow. Why I'm saying this is that what people perhaps do not know, that a study done jointly by the Punjab Agriculture University Ludhiana, Punjabi University Patiala, and the Guru Nanak Dev University in Amritsar, the three public sector universities, sometimes back had shown that between 2000 and 2015, a period of 15 years, 16,600 farmers and farm workers committed suicide in Punjab. I'm sure you will agree, if the farmers were rich, there is no reason why they should be committing suicide in such large numbers. Even today, pick up a newspaper, you know, there are chances that every day you'll find one or two suicides being reported. And, you know, this is one indication that the thinking by some people who want to brand Punjab farmers as pampered and, you know, the one who have a lot of money or who are rich is perhaps wrong. Also, the other part is that a study had also shown that every third farmer in Punjab is below the poverty line. So it tells you very clearly that the impression that we carry is perhaps based on our own assumptions to misbrand or to debrand this agitation as if it is being led by rich farmers. And in any case, let's not forget that in this country, only 4% farmers have land holding which is more than 10 hectares. So what kind of rich farmers are we talking about when only 4% farmers have more than 10 hectares of land? And you know, while the majority is small, as we know, 86% farmers in India have a land holding size of less than 5 acres. The remaining are what is called medium farmers who have a land holding, let's say, of 6, 7, 8 acres. Now, you know, to say that this agitation is being led by the people or the farmers who are basically rich or who are otherwise rich, and just because they get minimum support price, has also been challenged by another study which has recently come out, which said that in Punjab, roughly 70% of the small farmers get the benefit of minimum support price. And so it tells you very clearly that 70% of the small farmers would mean those who have less than 5 acres are the ones who benefit largely from the minimum support price. So I think this is a misinformation that is being spread, that Punjab farmers, the rich Punjab farmers, are behind this agitation. There are about 25,000 middlemen in Punjab. Maybe they are, officially there are 40,000, but the operative part is about 25,000 middlemen. And this feeling that they are the ones who are instigating this. The other charge is that, you know, it is being led by, or people are being misled by, political parties and vested interests and so on. And, you know, this all falls flat because, you know, in this dead of the winters, just go and stay outside your home for one night and you will get to know what it means. I don't think anybody would like to take that challenge, even if somebody is sponsoring that kind of a protest, as is being made out, that he would go and spend more than a month in the dead of the winter or in this kind of extreme winter situation, living in a trolley or living in a tent outside Delhi. I just invite these people to come and stay for just one night in a tent there. And I think they will learn that life is more precious than being sponsored by someone to go and do that job. So I think let's stop showing our contempt to farming community. It is a responsibility to understand that after all, you know, lakhs of people cannot be foolish. This movement, for the first time, all these unions have come on one platform. I think is a remarkable development, which, as I said earlier, none of us could actually work on it, in the sense that they could all come together under one platform, mm-hmm. or on one platform. So the fact that they have come on one platform, and there are 32 leaders from Punjab, and then there are other leaders, you know, because basically Haryana and so on, Rajasthan, Haryana, Western UP, and then of course across the country. But first of all, I think to bring them all together is something that we must acknowledge as, you know, unique effort being made by farming unions to voice their concern, because now they feel that, you know, this is the priority that they have to stand for. This is the combined effort it requires to see that, you know, this time they are able to push forth for their to stand up for their rights. I think that is remarkable. The other part is that I remember in our campaign on genetically modified crops, there would always be some groups which will support the genetically modified crops, and in a democracy all these activities always happen. So it's not something unique happening this time, that there are some groups which are saying these laws are good, and many of them are propped up by interest, vested interests, and so on. We all know that, you know, having a card and saying that you represent a farmer group is not very difficult, and we have seen that happening earlier also, and we see that happening now also. So I'm not surprised, but I think what is more important to say that such a large section has come out, and as I said earlier, has been camping outside Delhi, and as you rightly mentioned, they are not here for a picnic. So if the majority was in favor, I'm sure the number of people who have been in a protest wouldn't have been so huge. So I think let's honor and respect this, and then I think let's try to see what the farmers need and what we can do to help them, rather than getting into this that there are 10 other people who are supporting it and not. It will be important to see what numbers they carry behind them and so on and so forth. But in any case, I think even if a large chunk of the farming population is unhappy, I think it is time to stand up and take notice. In a business channel the other day, I was being interviewed and on a panel, and I said, the question asked to me was, you know, at a time when the markets are so excited about these farm laws, you know, why are the farmers unhappy around the streets? I said, you have answered the question yourself. You know, because the laws are in favor of the market, so they are excited. And the laws the farmers feel are not in their favor, so they are on the streets. So I think it is quite clear. The question that you asked and the question that the corporates pose is very clear. Because the tendency is to get into corporate agriculture now, because this is what the globe is moving towards, this is what the world is moving towards. But the past experience has been very unsatisfying as far as the role of the corporates in propping up farmers' income is concerned. You know, look at a country like America, from where we have borrowed these laws. I think it will be important to understand that in America, these open markets or the free trade in agriculture has existed for about 6 to 7 decades, in fact, even higher than that or more than that. And the farm incomes have been on a decline. You know, just imagine in 2020, this year, the farmers are saddled with a bankruptcy of more than $425 billion. Now, if the reforms were so good, I see no reason the farmer should be faced with that kind of bankruptcy. And then if you look at other data, what is happening to agriculture in America, it is also passing through a terrible, terrible stage of distress. Most Indians don't know that. You know, the rate of suicide in rural America is about 45% higher than urban America. You know, over the years, small farms have disappeared, as of course we all know, and only 1.5% farming of the total population now is engaged in farming in America. But still, America, as you know, is the biggest agriculture producer in the world. Mm-hmm. So I think it is time to understand that it's not, when we talk of agriculture in America, we are talking about corporates, the big machines, the big business, the big agriculture, and so on. But when we talk of agriculture in India, we're talking of millions of small farmers, marginal farmers, and so on. But please tell me, if agriculture was so profitable, or farmers had actually gained from these kinds of reforms, and in America, they don't have MSP, in America, they don't have APMC, in America, the big retail like Walmart does not have a stock limit, then there is contract farming, then there is also commodity trading. And yet, despite that, the American farmers are being given a subsidy of $62,000 every year. Now, this tells us that if the markets were efficient, I don't think that any government will be happy to pump in money into the agriculture sector or to the farm. The other part is, if you look at the OECD countries, the richest trading bloc, you find that every year they have been pumping out billions of dollars into agriculture by way of direct income support or by way of subsidies. Look at Europe. Europe today is getting about $100 billion of agriculture subsidies, and half of it roughly goes as direct income support to farmers. That incomes have declined in these countries where markets were operating. So what we see as market efficiency as far as agriculture and agriculture export is concerned actually is based on the federal support these governments have been providing to that particular sector. So I think we need to clarify, we need to make people understand that if it's not that the market are efficient there in the rich and developed countries, it is because of the subsidized support that the government provides year after year that agriculture is sustainable, economically viable in that sense. Now, the other part is even a country like China, where as you know, it is controlled markets, quote unquote, where they say markets operate, even in that condition, the way the political system operates there. China has now emerged as the biggest provider of agricultural subsidies in the world, beating even America and the European Union. So about $212 billion is the subsidy support China provided to agriculture in 2016. And the high income that you see in China is farm income, is because of these subsidies. Studies now show that 38% of the earnings of wheat farmers actually comes from these subsidies. So roughly about 32% of the earnings of the rice farmers in China come from these subsidies. It is not the high yield that they have, but it is the subsidies that actually gives farmers a higher income. When technology comes in, then the productivity goes up, and the productivity goes up, the income goes up. You have heard it all. Now look at America. I give you another example. America had, since 1970s or even prior to that, they had a number of small dairy farms, and these dairy farms were, of course, technology rich, and having cattle which were very productive, very high yielding, and all those kind of things. We all agree with that, or I'm sure we will agree with that particular. This that American dairy farms were a kind of a model for us to follow. Now, I remember some 10, 12 years back, I read a report in the New York Times, shocking, I would say. Shocking in the sense that, of course, we hear of suicides happening everywhere in the world. But I think what actually shook me personally was that this particular case, the farmer, he was so distressed by the market crash in prices of milk prices that he first shot each of his 51 cows and then he shot himself. Now, this was about 12, 13 years back. Now, the point I'm trying to make is that distress has prevailed in America over the decades, and we don't even know about it. Now, if you look at it, what has happened in America is that 93% of the dairy farms have closed down since 1970s, and yet milk production has gone up. Normally, we would believe that when the dairy farms are closing down in such a large number, then of course it means that the milk production is coming down. But on the other hand, the milk production is going up in America because big corporates are moving and they're getting into mega dairies, and then the milk prices have crashed, and that is why we see 93% of the dairy farms closing down. Now, the point I'm trying to make here is if technology and if productivity was the criteria, then I see no reason why these dairy farms would have closed down. They closed down because of the market prices getting, or declining over the period, and which means that even they could not cover their cost of production, and that is why they preferred to go out. This is not only one example. You can give number of such examples to understand these things that we claim would increase farmers' income actually hasn't helped it. What actually needs, or what actually has been established today, is that farmers need direct income support. As I said earlier, if in Europe 50% of these subsidies are going as direct income support, as I said in China also, if much of the income increase is because of the subsidies that China provides, in America, as I said earlier, $62,000 is the subsidy support on an average to each farmer in a year. I think it tells us that markets are not the factor. It is primarily the subsidies which are actually sustaining whatever remains in agriculture today. What Swaminathan had suggested was that over comprehensive cost, Now, the comprehensive cost in that language means C2 cost, interest paid on capital and so on and so forth. And so that was the cost that Swaminathan had worked out and said that we need to provide farmers 50% higher than that, that the C2 cost. But what the government has done is there's another factor called A2 plus FL. Now, A2 plus FL means, A2 means out of the pocket expenses, like for instance, farmers spent on fertilizer, pesticides, and so on. So all those expenses plus family labor. And then over that, A2 plus FL, they are saying 50% higher income or higher prices being provided. So there is a difference between these two. What the government claims is A2 plus FL plus 50%. And what Swaminathan suggested was C2 cost plus 50%. So there is quite a difference here. And I think we need to understand that. So, just to believe that the government has said that we are providing higher price has also to be seen from another aspect that, you know, so far we have only two commodities primarily, wheat and rice, where the government steps in and buys, at least in Punjab and Haryana and in some other parts of the country, whatever comes into the mandi, they buy it, but not for other crops. And even in the case of wheat and paddy, it is only in those areas where the APMC network of mandis exist. So beyond that, you know, farmers are into distress, say. So I think it must be very clear for the people that, this is what the farmers are actually demanding, is that what operates in Punjab and Haryana should now become a kind of a pan-India program, because everywhere farmers need to get a higher income. And even if the MSP is low, at least that's an assured price can accept. So I think what is more, farmers are actually fighting for that they need, like you and me, or like everyone else, you know, when you walk away with your paycheck every month, you know, farmers also are not asking for that kind of a paycheck, but are saying at least they should be assured of a reasonable income every month, and which there's the mechanism that exists globally or in India. I think MSP is the right barometer for that. This is a juncture when the kind of movement that we have seen should actually make us all stand up and take notice and to see that what kind of corrections can we bring in. First of all, like you and me, every farmer also needs to have an assured price. And at least he be sure that after the harvest, when he goes into the mandi, he will at least get that minimum price. If there can be a minimum wage for the workers, I don't understand why there can't be a minimum price for the farmers. Now, having said that, what is the way to bring that or to ensure that price that we are talking about? As I said earlier, you know, the only way that at least I know of looking at the global experience is MSP, minimum support price. In fact, that is a strength of India. Because, you know, our policymakers did a remarkable job at the time of the Green Revolution when they introduced the minimum support price for wheat and paddy. At that time, they wanted to push the production of staple foods. But I think that's something which has stood the test of the time. There are problems in the mandis. Yes, we need to, reform the structure of the mandis. I completely agree with that. But throwing away the mandis, as they say, throwing the baby with the bathwater is not what is required. So I would suggest there are, first of all, two things that would be, as far as pricing is concerned. Make MSP legal for the 23 crops that the MSP is announced every year. Every year, the government announces minimum support price for 23 crops, but effectively buys only wheat and paddy. To some extent, some cotton, pulses, and so on as the need arises, but primarily it is wheat and paddy. So this needs to be expanded and extended to all the 23 crops for which the government announces the price. This is important. Let me just give you one illustration. You know, in a wire analysis showed, that in October, November, 2 months, they analyze the data from the government's own portal, marketing portal, where they give you details about how much, different crops have been sold in these 2 months and what price and so on. So they analyze that data and they have said that if the farmers had got MSP, and this is across the board, not only for wheat and paddy, if the farmers had got MSP, they would have gained by 1900 crore rupees in just 2 months. I'm sure you will agree 1900 crore is not a small amount. And considering that, as I said earlier, that in half the country, the average income is only 20,000 rupees a year. Imagine the kind of economic benefit it would have given to those farmers to sustain their livelihoods. If you look at the share of the gross cropped area in the country, 80% of the gross cropped area is covered by these 23 crops. So that means a large section of the farming population is covered by a minimum support price regime if it is implemented effectively or it's made legal. And that should be a legal right for farmers, which means also it will be the real azadi for farmers, a real freedom for farmers. He knows whether he sells in Samrala in Punjab or whether he sells in Bihar, Champaran in Bihar, he knows that he will be getting the same price, or at least he will be getting the minimum support price. That's the kind of freedom that the farmers are expecting. Everyone is so excited. As you said in the very beginning, that the corporates are saying we'll be able to give farmers a higher price. Higher price to what? After all, the only benchmark we have is MSP. So if you're already willing to pay a higher price, economists are saying you'll get a higher price. Policymakers are saying you will get a higher price. Farmers are being misled and so on. So if that is true, then what is the objection or what is the problem in setting MSP as a minimum barrier or a minimum level to which the farmer must, for which or to at which the farmer should be assured that he will get that kind of income? So when everybody is excited about giving farmers a higher income, then I think the corporate sector should actually be standing with the farmers saying that, yes, let's make MSP a legal right, because we are in any case going to give them a higher price. But it's not happening, which means what the corporate sector claims is not being honest, I would say. And they know that they will not be able to give a higher price. I know many of the corporate activists who appear on the television have been saying that if the center brings in a fourth law, which makes minimum support price legal across the country, then the reforms would crash. Or reforms would collapse. Mm-hmm. That means you are yourself admitting that you are not going to give farmers a higher price. So there has to be some kind of assurance, and that assurance, in my understanding, is the minimum support price, making it legal. Number two, delivering minimum support price is also a problem. In this country, we have about 7,000 mandis, APMC regulated mandis. What we need in this country is 42,000 mandis if you have to set up a mandi in 5 kilometer radius. So I don't think that's an infrastructure we cannot create. That's something which should be priority number one, because after all, even if the farmer is, let's say, selling in Bihar and he has a marketing platform, then I think it helps him to overcome the distress sale and get a better price discovery. And if the MSP is there, in fact, I have said many places that MSP is the real price discovery in India. I've not seen corporates or the companies or the big trade giving farmers a higher price than the minimum support price. So which means MSP is basically the price discovery that farmers can look up to. Having said that, so if we have a network of mandis laid out, then the mechanism of MSP delivery becomes easy. In America, all these decades of free markets, US Department of Agriculture tells us that the share of a farmer in every food dollar, which means if a consumer is spending $1 on food, buying food, the farmer share is only 8%. Now, it tells you very clearly why the American farmer is in a crisis today. 8% is a share out of every dollar that the consumer spends. Now, compare that with Amul Dairy Cooperative in India. That's again our own strength. And why not we draw a lesson from the Amul Dairy Cooperative? The Amul Dairy Cooperative chairman has gone on record saying that when you buy Amul milk for 100 rupees, let's say, 70 rupees go to farmers, which means 70% is the share of farmer in every 100 rupees that you spend as far as milk is concerned, the cooperative milk is concerned. So why not replicate that model in vegetables, in pulses, in fruits, and so on, and ensure that the farmers get a larger share of the food dollar or of the consumer's end price. So I think that is what is needed. Why are we ashamed of not trying our homegrown model? My point is, let's learn from our own strengths and build on that kind of a strength, so that instead of opening up agriculture for the cooperatives to come and exploit further, I think what should be required is how to expand the cooperative network in this country. Try how to learn or to experiment that, how to make that work for vegetables, fruits, and so on. One last thing is that we have always treated, the economic design has always treated agriculture to be a burden on the society. The argument is that unless we move people out of agriculture into the urban areas, we will not have economic growth. I think this has to change. Lockdown has shown us, just in 2 days of lockdown, we saw 80 million people go into reverse migration, interstate and intrastate. And that tells us that the model of pushing people out of rural areas into the urban areas was a flawed economic model. And I think we need to reverse that model. And, the possibility of making agriculture a powerhouse of economic growth is what is required today.